Blessings, everybody, and welcome to StellarMace. Have you heard about the Russian bogatyrs? Did you ever look on Ukrainian embroidery and ask, what's the story behind it? If so, then you came to the right place. If you are an aspiring world builder or just a fan of Eastern Europe, this channel is dedicated to you. So be sure to subscribe for future content. Today, I will tell you about Vyshyvanka. For those of you that have no idea what I just said, Vyshyvanka is a national Ukrainian shirt. That white one that you see in the pictures. I'll tell you its brief history, and then delve into the vibrant embroidery. Now, before I do that, I am working on a story of mine, which I hope to, if the fates be good to me, turn into an animated series in the future. And I'll share some details of my fictional world at the end of each video. If you also felt inspired, feel welcome to share in the comment section. Now, back to Vyshyvanka. Vyshyvanka gets its name from the vibrant embroidery. It was not only fashionable, but also had a magical purpose. While the woman's version is way more decorative with much embroidery along the front and the sleeves, the man's version is fairly reserved, embroidered only along the cuffs, the collars, and the iconic placket on the front. Having too much ornamentation would not look very manly, if you will. While one may think that this fancy design is a recent invention, it is actually very old, being mentioned in several medieval texts. I personally enjoy how in the Petyev Chronicle of 1252, one of the Slavic princes is described wearing a net over himself, probably referring to the rhombuses that are so definitive to the Western Ukrainians. In the Cherkasy Oblast, they found several statuettes, over 1400 years old. Remarkably, they display the iconic design of the men's Vyshyvanka seen today. Even farther into history, Herodotus spoke of the Scythians, which are an earlier culture inhabiting what is now southern Ukraine, and he distinguished them for their embroidered clothes. Even before them, a Stone Age culture known as the Tripilians have left a variety of trinkets, hinting that they also most likely embroidered their clothes. Though their culture as well as their style were vastly different, it is most likely that the purpose was all the same. In the Ukrainian culture, Vyshyvanka comes in several different types, serving several different roles. There was one for work, one for everyday life, and one for special events, the latter being, of course, the most decorated. At the end of winter, Ukrainians would celebrate the Day of Sowing, a ritualistic event when the people would pray for good harvest, and a separate Vyshyvanka was made for that. Another type of Vyshyvanka was made for the wedding. This one was worn only once in a lifetime. On a wedding. And then kept away in a stash as if to preserve the family. Oh, and speaking of the wedding, one of the Ukrainian traditions, which I'll cover in the future, is that before getting married, a girl would weave a separate Vyshyvanka for her future mother-in-law. Before it is finished, this Vyshyvanka would be washed in salty water in order to prevent future tears and discord. Another interesting custom is to make the woman's Vyshyvanka out of either hemp or linen, believing that these plant-based fabrics would magically protect the future mother and her children. When a person passes away, they would be buried in their Vyshyvanka, though these traditions are probably lost to most people in the modern day. Nowadays, Vyshyvanka is just seen as a beautiful piece of fashion and a symbol of national pride, not even realizing the true purpose that it used to carry. An extremely valued possession, oftentimes these clothes were valued more than money. That is because apart from being fashionable, Vyshyvanka also carried a magical power. Before Ukraine was a thing, people would practice a special type of magic system that by embroidering special images onto their clothes, they would channel positive energy and protective charms. Children would be given their own Vyshyvanka with symbols to protect them from evil spirits and disease. Elements of flowers were supposed to attract good fortune. It was believed that if your embroidery had a messy pattern, then your life would also be messy. Meanwhile, copying someone else's design was like trying to copy their fate, and therefore, not a very good idea. Skilled embroidery was much valued throughout Ukraine. Back in the day, there would be professional women in each village that would do all the sacred embroidery for pay. There were also those things called haftyarstva, large-scale centers of professional embroiderers located in large cities, such as Kiev, Lviv, and Brody. They would weave for the Kazakh starshina and for the nobility. Let's look a little bit on the regional styles, and then finish it off with some of the motifs that were used. Though nowadays you can embroider with literally any color of the rainbow, the original three are white, red, and black. Red is the most important. Being the most vibrant of the three, it was a color of beauty. I mean, it still is. Look at it. The Russian word «красивый», meaning beautiful, originates from «красный», meaning red. And it is very common in old literature to call a beautiful girl a red girl. Red is also associated with energy, vitality, and youth. Therefore, it is the younger ones that would wear bright red. Red and black could be paired to make two opposites, conveying ecstasy and grief, life and death. Different regions in Ukraine use different styles, and an expert can always tell where the Vyshyvanka came from by looking at its style. Ukraine could be divided into three zones: northwest, east, and the center. Northwest is made up of two regions, north and west. In the north, we got the Polesian region, which literally means on the forest. And in the west, we got the Carpathian Mountains. Both the Polesians and the Carpathians, being isolated from foreign invaders, have managed to preserve the more ancient geometric styles, although there are still differences between them. Carpathians are unique in that they use a wide variety of colors, greens, blues, yellows, and so on. Meanwhile, the Polesians stick to the more traditional, red on white, with subtle additions of black. The Carpathian styles are also more rough by appearance, featuring large diamonds compacted together and outlined by dark contours. The Polesians, on the other hand, use small elements with more breathing space, giving a much more tender appearance. Moving to the east, we start noticing a lot of fluid flowers. That is a latecomer due to invaders and foreign influences. I find it funny how it's way harder to browse the eastern styles. I spent twice as much time looking for the traditional embroidery of Donetsk with only half as many results as I got for Ternopil. Saying much? I don't know. People of this region generally stick to the same traditional colors of white, red, and black, although black is usually replaced by dark green to make foliage for the flowers. The southernmost region of Crimea features a rather unique style, of which I'm going to talk in just a minute. In between the two regions, in Poltava, Cherkasy, Kirovograd, and so on, there are the intermediate styles. These are usually hybrids, featuring flowers and plants, but sticking to a geometric interpretation. Now that we have a general picture, let's take a look at some of the unique instances. Odessa, surrounded by regions using squares and rhombuses, is noteworthy for a sudden prevalence of circles. Some of the central regions, such as Zhytomyr, Vinnytsia, and Poltava, feature white-on-white embroidery, giving it almost angelic appearance. The famous Borshev city is one dot on the map featuring a black-dominated palette. The story behind it is rather tragic. According to a legend, when the invading Tatars came, they killed all the men in the villages, and so the women started weaving their clothes with black. There are several other styles worth mentioning, but I reserve the last mention for the southernmost region. Its primary color being pale yellow, the Crimean embroidery is by far the most unique and quite literally alien style to Ukraine. The story behind it is when the Tatars established their Khanate in the region, they sought for skilled embroiderers to decorate their courts. Naturally, a lot of Ukrainian women started to show up and learn the Tatar style. They would be much valued for their skill and protected. As I am wrapping this up, let's talk about the motifs and some of the meanings behind them. This is going to be a very brief overview, since the video is already getting long enough. If you want me to get into more detail, make sure to comment and let me know.
And subscribe to be on the lookout.
There are three types of motifs: geometric, or basic shapes and lines; vegetative, or plants; and zoomorphic, animals. Beginning with geometric, this is the most ancient style in the region and can be traced back to pagan roots. The square, with its four sides, would usually represent the world with its four cardinal directions, or the house with its four walls. In this regard, it would be a symbol of structure, harmony, and balance. The most widely used shape is a rhombus, as imagine you can tell. Due to its pervasive usage, this shape collected an entire baggage of different meanings. Being made from two triangles put together, it may represent the union of two opposites, such as male and female, day and night, spiritual and earthly. When there is a dot inside, or a flower to that extent, it becomes a fruitful field. Oftentimes, a rhombus would be associated with fields, earth, agriculture, household, as well as mountains and even the sun. There are a variety of other shapes, such as the circle, representing the sun, moon, divine power, and a wheel of time, as well as a star, a symbol of guardianship and protection. Now let's talk about the plants. And when I talk about the plants, you must remember one thing.
Flowers.
Flowers are everything. If you imagine the Ukrainian culture without flowers, then you do not have the Ukrainian culture. Perhaps I am over-exaggerating a bit, yet regardless, flowers are a very common motif in all of Ukrainian art. As you would have guessed, they are a symbol of beauty and fertility, as well as life, youth, vitality, strong emotions, wealth, prosperity, and are basically luck charms. There are two that are most important: poppy flowers, the grand red ones, and cornflowers, the cutesy small ones. Poppy flowers have been historically used to ward off evil and attract good fortune. They would be dried up and hung near the door to prevent entrance to any corrupt spirit. They also embody passion and glory. And after the Soviet Union, they have also become associated with courage and martyrdom, because they resemble blood-stained bullet wounds. Cornflowers embody humility and tenderness, and are associated with the blue skies and a girl's eyes. Apart from flowers, just to name a few, Ukrainians also use the guelder rose, which is associated with motherhood and care, grapes, associated with family, wealth, and happiness, and the oak, endurance, guardianship, and fatherhood. Animals are by far the rarest motif in traditional Ukrainian embroidery. They may feature horses, squirrels, deer, but the most common are birds. Among these, roosters and doves are usually associated with weddings, roosters in particular being also associated with household and prosperity. Storks are a very important bird in Ukrainian culture due to the fact that they make their nests in the most calm places and that they mate for life. They are symbols of peace and integrity. If a stork makes its nest on your roof, then it will mean that your house shall be blessed with peace and harmony. And children, somehow. A mythical creature, the firebird, is prevalent in context of glory, prosperity, and enlightenment. If you ever browse for it, then I bet you've stumbled at least once upon the drawing of Ivan catching a bird for the Tsar, a very famous story that I may discuss in the future. Well, this is pretty much it for the first video. Now, before I say my farewells, I'll tell you about the Sonesans, a fictional culture group that I was inspired to create for my story. I'll give you half a second to guess what word Sonesan comes from. It comes from the sun. Yes, wow, so genius. Anyways, it is that association with the sun that sets the Sonesans apart from their cultural relatives. In order to channel the divine solar energy, Sonesans embroidery is woven with yellow or golden threads. Their ceremonious attire, which I'm looking to draw in the next video, is entirely yellow and is meant to bring protection, prosperity, and harmony. If one was somehow lost or stolen, it would spell disaster for the family. Their ornamentation features fluid floral motifs, which, like the Eastern Ukrainian styles, is brought on by foreign influences. Their association with the sun is also a foreign influence. These flowers would be woven onto monotone fields with clear borders, representing a garden enclosed by a fence. A devout and conservative people, this style is supposed to represent their beliefs. So yeah, I hope you find that interesting. If you also found some inspiration for your projects, feel welcome to share in the comments. I would love to see what you got. For my next video, I would talk about the Ukrainian headwear. And spoiler alert, the Sonesan headwear that you see here on the screen is not an example native to Ukraine, but is actually inspired by the Tatars. More on that next time. I am planning to post each Saturday.
So if you like the content, be sure to subscribe and be on the lookout.
A shout out for folk costumes and embroidery, a blog post dedicated to sharing the passion of Eastern European wear. The post gets into much detail on traditional outfits and is a treasure trove of information for those that are interested or those that are looking to design their own costumes. You may also be interested in following me on Instagram under the name Timofey36. Don't ask me why I chose that name, please. In any case, good luck on your world building, have a charming day, and see you in the next Sobota.